I'm Drew Purves, head of the Computational Ecology and Environmental Science Group at Microsoft Research in Cambridge in the UK. And I spend my days building computer simulation models of plants, animals, and even whole ecosystems. The typical day for us is we would think about something in reality that we care about, whether it's an individual plant or a whole forest or oceans, all kinds of different aspects of the Earth system. And we would be discussing what we think is going on in that system, on the one hand, in reality, and how we can encode that into a computer model, on the other hand, so that we can actually simulate that system in a computer. So what is a model and why is it important? What we mean by a model is really a mathematical description of something that occurs in reality. But then nowadays we'll take that mathematical model and we'll put it into a computer program that we simulate in a computer. So a very familiar example might be something like a mechanical model of a bridge, where we have reliable physical models in mathematics, and we can simulate the bridge in the computer and see whether it might collapse or not if different things happen to it. So, but nowadays, because of fast computers and some new statistical methods and so on, we think that it's now possible to do that for much more complex natural systems like plants and animals and even whole ecosystems like forests. In our lab, one of the overarching concerns is the impact of climate change on ecosystems, whether they're approximately natural ecosystems like, let's say, boreal forests, or semi-natural systems like farms and arable fields, pastures, that kind of thing. And so we have a relatively good understanding now of the physical side of climate change. There are still some important uncertainties, but we have a relatively good physical understanding of the impact of carbon dioxide change on the temperature. What we have much less of an understanding of is the knock-on effects of that climate change on natural ecosystems. And so that's something we're looking at many different scales, taking all the data that we can. So nowadays we have amazing data sources available, and then we're coding up models of things like forests and so on, and then we'll change the climate to try to estimate the potential impact of climate change on the forests. One of our biggest projects to date has been a new model of the terrestrial carbon cycle. That model describes all of the flows of carbon between the atmosphere in the form of carbon dioxide through photosynthesis into plants, into the soil, and back out into the atmosphere. And that cycle is happening everywhere where there's vegetation. Now, there were previous examples of models of that system, and they had clearly shown that the carbon cycle was potentially very important for the future of climate change. So it could either be a significant brake or a significant turbocharge on future climate change. But the models disagreed. And so what we wanted to begin to do was to take a model, we built a new model, but the main difference was to anchor that model as carefully as we could against as many sources of data as we could get our hands on. And so this model is plausible in the sense that it's consistent with everything that we think we know about the real carbon cycle, but at the same time it's anchored against all the observations and the data. Now at the moment, the predictions of that model are still very uncertain, and it's missing some important features like the impact of CO2. So we're only beginning, but we think that we've been able to show that it's at least in principle possible to build a really good, accurate, predictive model of something as huge and complex as the terrestrial carbon cycle. There are several reasons for building models of any natural system, whether it's a cell, a plant, or a whole ecosystem. So one of them is that it's a different way to aggregate together what we think we know about that system, what we've learned from the reductionist science, and to aggregate that back together into a model of the whole to see whether we think we approximately understand what's going on or whether there are some important gaps that we haven't thought about and so on. So models are important in guiding the science. They can give us new insights into the behavior or perhaps the evolution of that system. We can suddenly realize, oh, this is actually what that system seems to do. Especially for something like a whole plant, we might be able to ask, what is it that it's actually evolved to do? And then finally, of course, those models can then make useful predictions. That can be a prediction about perhaps a place we've never visited, so how might wheat yield in a place where it's never been grown? It can be a prediction about the future, so how might wheat production respond to climate change? Or it might be a prediction about an intervention, so how would wheat production change in this place if we were to irrigate, or even if we were to reprogram the behaviour of the individual plants. And finally, all of that together gives you, at least we hope, a package for better decision making. Because ultimately, the people that make the important decisions that are going to determine whether or not we all have a sustainable future are not scientists by and large. And so what we hope is that in creating these models and packaging them and communicating them in the right way, we might be able to give the decision makers better information and enable them to make better decisions.